everybody. Welcome to Shoshana Rose Radio Program. I'm your teacher and your host and your friend, Ann Finkelman. And I'm delighted that you tuned in today. Oh my gosh. Listen, God sends the most anointed men and women to this ministry, and it's spirit-led. And those of you that watch regularly, you know God handpicks who he wants in this program. And everybody loves this program because it's a God program. And today is no different. We have two wonderful, wonderful men of God that you are going to enjoy tremendously, seasoned men of God, Dr. Jerry Brandt, Apostle Dr. Jerry Brandt, and this is a true evangelist. You will hear as this program goes on. This is Daniel McGee. Mm-hmm. And I'll let them introduce themselves. And if you want to find me on Facebook, Ann Finkelman, Shoshana Ministries International, you know where I am. Listen, I know you can do much with your time. I so appreciate you taking an hour of your time to spend it with God's people, to spend it on Shoshana Rose Radio Program. And today you're going to be fed the Word of God. If you have an evangelistic heart or apostolic heart, or you just want to know about God, you want to know about Jesus Christ, this is the program. And because we have an apostle and evangelist, as always, we're going to have a call for salvation. So if you've left the Father's house and you don't know how to get back, today's your day to come back to Father's house. Or if you've never known the salvation, the beautiful love of Jesus Christ, today's your day. And when you close your eyes for the last time, beloved of God, you will get to spend eternity with God because of Jesus Christ. So without further ado, I want to give my guests much time because we have two powerhouses here. Mm-hmm. And so I'm going to kind of step back a little bit and let them introduce themselves. Dr. Jerry Brandt, would you greet my audience? And
absolutely. Thank you so much for putting us on your broadcast today. We're excited to share the good news of Jesus Christ. And let me tell you, you need some good news right now in the middle of all the bad news. And the news is so great. It's about God's love.
Amen.
It's about God's authority and power for your life to raise you up to who you should be. We have a lot of identification theology here at Kingdom. I'm the president and founder of Kingdom Life University. Mm-hmm. We're in 19 different nations. We have 70 international directors in many countries. Mm-hmm. And we're raising up nationals all over the world. You were talking about a little beforehand about sons. You know, I've got hundreds of sons.
Yes.
They all call me Papa,
yes.
Daddy,
and
around the world, and daughters. Mm-hmm. And daughters, absolutely. Well, sons, it's inclusive.
Yes,
daughters,
inclusive.
And sons.
Absolutely.
Because we make no difference with
absolutely.
Christ. There's neither male nor female.
And a good father you are.
You know what? I love children. I love my sons. And I want to see them excel. Daniel's one of my sons, you know, and you've been associated with another great, great ministry, Dr. Rodney Howard Brown's ministry. You've been his evangelist on staff there for years. And but I just look at Daniel as a son. He's getting a doctorate degree,
amen.
By the way, with our Kingdom Life University. And so Daniel is a part of us, and I just bless the day that I met you down in Belgrade, Florida,
yes,
where you're holding a tent revival, winning souls like crazy. Over 3,000 souls came to the Lord in a city of 13,000 people.
Yes.
I mean, did you hear this? This man is an evangelist, so I'm going to turn it over to you for a minute.
You know,
introduce yourself, please.
So I'm Daniel McGee, founder of Rural Revival America, and we've heard much prophetic utterance that have come forward from the prophets of what would happen in rural America. Before I ever heard any of those prophecies, I was on staff with Dr. Rodney Howard Brown there at the River in Tampa, Florida, and Revival Ministries International. I was his staff evangelist for many years, and the Lord had put in my heart a ministry called Rural Revival America to take revival to the rural communities of America, the small places of America, if you will. And then the prophecies began to come when Dr. Perry Stone released the prophecy in early 2016 that revival would come to the rural communities of America. I sent his ministry to either 26 or 28 cities that we had already seen major revivals break out in. And Dr. Jerry with Kingdom Life University just gave you guys talk about Belgrade, Florida. Now, Belgrade, Florida was once known as the AIDS capital of the world. Not the AIDS capital of America, but the AIDS capital of the world, because more people had the HIV virus there per capita than anywhere else in the world. Not only was it that, it was a 98 out of a 100 on a violent crime scale. One of the most violent small cities in America. Crime, rape, murder, homicide. Mm. And the Holy Spirit sent me in there. Within the first week we were there, we led over 500 people to Jesus, glory to God. We put up a big giant tent, a 1,000-seater tent, So many people showed up on the opening night in the most violent area of the city. Yeah. By the time we left Belgrade, Florida, over 3,100 people confessed Ooh. Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord, and a regional move of God broke out because it went from there to the next city, Pahokee, and then the South Bay. The whole that whole area woke up with revival. We literally led somewhere around 5,000 to 6,000 people to Jesus. So and that's how we met.
Now that's the true heart of the evangelist. Yes. You know, we were discussing at lunch before this broadcast that the church world as a whole, you know, when I say a whole, or the ecclesia as a whole, they call everybody to say, oh, what do? I travel. Oh, you're a traveling evangelist.
That's true.
No, according to Ephesians 4, 10, 11, the ascension gifts, Ephesians 4, 10, Ephesians 4, 11, Jesus gave gifts when he ascended on high, he gave gifts unto men. So for those of us that think the prophet, the apostle, prophet, pastor, teacher, and evangelist passed away, no, it didn't.
That's right.
Because Ephesians 4, 10, the ascension gifts, it reads, he that ascended on high, the same ascended up far above all heaven, that he might fill all things, verse 11, and he gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers. And you say, well, why is that? Well, all I need is my pastor. No, we need the apostle, the prophet, the pastor, teacher, and evangelist in our church buildings for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Why? Listen up. Till we all come into the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God under a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Now, first, verse 14, beloved, that we henceforth be no more children.
Come on.
Come on now. Tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine, every false prophet that comes through, every false preacher that comes through, that you grow up well-rounded, that we're not tossed to and fro with every wind carried away.
There you go.
With every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby wherein they lie in wait to deceive. And verse 15, but speaking the truth in love,
amen,
may grow up unto him in all things which is the head, even Christ. Which one do you want to
be? Ooh, wow.
Now that's what we're supposed to be doing.
It's one of my favorite sections of scripture you know, I've been teaching fivefold ministries now for 30 years. Ever since I got baptized in the Holy Spirit. See, I was a Baptist, went to a school called Bob Jones University, Denver Baptist Seminary. It was Baptist to the core. And we taught cessationism. That, in other words, that the gifts died at the end of the first century. And the only thing left was teachers and evangelists and pastors. We discounted the apostles. We discounted the prophets. And as a result, we were robbing ourselves for a lot of years of revelation knowledge. What was the church built on? Jesus asked the disciples, who do men say that I am? And some say, well, you're Elijah the prophet. Some say John the Baptist. And then Peter answered, he says, you are the Son of the living God. And Jesus said to Peter, flesh and blood, Peter, has not revealed that to you, but my Father, which is in heaven, has given you the revelation of who I am. And then Jesus said, on this rock,
Come on now,
I will build my church. What's the rock? It's revelation. See, the church is built on revelation. And that's what Kingdom Life University, by the way, is all about. That's what Daniel's all about. When this man preaches, God gives us revelation. He gives us a new understanding of who he is and who we are and what he's doing on the earth today. And so you wet my whistle now, lady. Come on.
That's the Holy Spirit.
Yeah, I'm telling you.
He wants his people, his loves, to know the truth and operate and grow up.
You know, the church has largely been just a place of information. Go get a little study here, a little information there. No! I want to go to church and hear the revelation of what God's saying.
That's right.
What is
the
Spirit saying to the church?
Hallelujah.
Seven times in the book of Revelation.
Hallelujah.
John said, he that hath ears to hear, let him hear what the
Spirit
is saying. And you know the next verse every time you hear this? The next verse, for he that overcomes.
Uh-huh.
Who are the overcomers?
Uh-huh.
Those that hear the voice of the Spirit.
That's us. Come on, raise your hand.
Raise your other hand, Daniel. You're off screen there. Yeah, there you go.
Raise your hand.
Yeah, that's a very powerful section.
Isn't
of scripture.
That wonderful?
And you know, here's another thing we talked. You just talked about the gift of the evangelist, and you had said that, and we've seen this in America for far too long.
That's right.
And that's why the church has to grow up.
It does.
They calling many people that travel, they're calling them an evangelist. Well, scripturally, that's not an evangelist.
That's exactly right.
Just because a person travels, it does not make them an evangelist. Other than Jesus Christ, your New Testament example of an evangelist is Philip of Acts chapter 8.
That's
There's
right.
your New Testament example.
That's right.
So just because somebody comes to your church and preaches a good message, feel-good message that encouraged the body of Christ, and you see some people prayed for to be healed, which everybody in the body of Christ is
That's
called
right.
to win souls. Everybody in the body of Christ is called to lay hands on the sick. Everybody's called to do that. That doesn't make them an evangelist. What makes that person an evangelist, which is the calling of Jesus Christ, by the way, and a true evangelist is going to shake cities.
There you go.
They are going to have testimonies. And we just gave one testimony. I can sit here and give you 72 cities of America that have been shaken by the hand of God, that anywhere from 300 to 10,000 in America. We did one city in 10 days, and over 10,800 people came to Jesus in the United States of America,
wow.
ladies and gentlemen.
Evangelist.
Wow.
Okay? So hundreds and hundreds of people coming into Jesus, putting tents up, doing outreaches, cookouts, whatever it takes to win the lost, drawing the masses in.
There you go.
The mass numbers of people. That's how you know you have a true ministry you've called the evangelist, not just because the person travels from church to church, but that the person is drawing mass numbers of people to Jesus. The heartbeat of the evangelist, the longest finger on your hand is our middle finger, and that's the outreach arm of the evangelist,
that's
reaching
right.
out to the lost and bringing them to the knowledge of Jesus Christ. Then you turn them over to the pastors of the local churches, which we do.
That's
turn them to the pastors and the teachers and the prophets, so they all mature.
That's right. And that's right. So we have the apostle, and also 1 Corinthians chapter 12 talks about first apostles, secondarily prophets. Mm-hmm. Prophets, if you're out there, if you know that mm-hmm. you are called to be a prophet of God, not because you prophesy, we're all supposed to be prophesying. All of us that are born again have the Holy Spirit in our belly. We have the nine gifts of the Holy Spirit living in us. We can prophesy, we can lay hands on the sick, the Great Commission. We can do all of the works of Jesus, but as office of the prophet, the fivefold ministry of the prophet is something specific. Now, if you're a prophet, you have to work with an apostle somewhere.
Mm.
Why I say that?
Yes.
I say, okay, because the prophet is sometimes way out there.
Mm-hmm.
And the apostle is the father figure, governmental authority. He balances the prophet, and the prophet sometimes has eyes to see where the apostle doesn't see it, because the seers come into the realm of the prophet. Now, let me say this. The apostle, prophet, pastor, teacher, evangelist all have their own gifts, all their equipment God gives them from heaven. We can't be something we're not called to do.
Amen.
The apostle operates the only one. He's the thumb. He touches every single finger. Okay, so he operates at any given time where the Spirit of God wills, as the apostle, the father, the prophet. Sometimes you say, wow, he's in the move of the prophet. He'll start prophesying, he'll become a seer, he'll become a watchman. And so he operates in the prophet, he operates in the pastor, the pastoral. He'll coddle the sheep, which prophets don't coddle the sheep. They don't have
That's
the
right.
patience to paddle the
they
sheep.
Shear the
you know,
sheep.
They shear the sheep. You know, they zip, 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 grow up.
That's
you
right.
know? But they have to walk in love, have to
That's
love,
right.
or it's like a clanking
yeah.
cymbal, you know, cymbal. And so the apostle will be the father, prophet, pastor, teacher. The apostle will break open the word and talk about the Greek and explain every word.
Amen.
Okay? And the evangelist, he'll always have an altar call, who wins souls,
That's right.
have a heart for souls. He's the only one that has all five. Now, the prophet is the mind, the will, and the purpose
right.
of God, bringing you into holiness, bringing you into the presence of God, brings the presence of God,
mm-hmm.
okay? The apostle can bring the presence of God through the prophetic anointing, okay? Now, the evangelist, oh my gosh, the evangelist comes in and explodes the whole place,
yeah.
winning souls, wake up with the cymbals
wake
and
up.
The drums, and wake up, and wants to go out in the city and get every soul that isn't tied down, and bring them into the house of the Lord.
Amen.
Okay, that's the evangelist. The teacher, you know, sometimes you just stand there and say, okay, the Greek, and this is what the Greek says, and the strong says, and the vine says, and that's the teacher. Break. The pastor, it's like raising a family, beloved, that never gets raised. They will coddle the same person for 10 years and never require them to do anything else but lay on their shoulder. because they have the heart of the shepherd. They have that patience built into them, the long-suffering built into them. So we're teaching this program today to balance the body of Christ.
Amen.
You should pay for this Bible college material. This is Bible college material, but we are giving it to you for free as unto God today. And I'm so glad that you can watch it over and over again. So men of God, I would like you to talk about, over the years you have been around the world. Let's talk about that, and then how you go in, and today when Pastor A, okay, the Spirit of God,
that's right,
he spoke to me when I was in that seat, and he said to me, Pastor A, April's going to ask Daniel to be at her church, and Daniel's going to want to evangelize the whole city and knock on doors. Because I had evangelists around me when I was coming up in the Lord. So I want to talk about that. How to get pastors to build their church. Not by, you know, sin every day, the same people over and over. We're supposed to go out to the highways and byways and compel them to come into the house of the Lord.
Amen. So, Dr. Jerry?
Well, you know, the Word says, for God so loved the what?
World.
The Word. See, God doesn't think just locally. He thinks worldwide. And Jesus died for the sins of the world, the whole world. So the whole world needs to hear the good news. Now, let me say something about the international harvest. It's misunderstood a lot. The unreached people groups of the world are really greatly misunderstood. Let me just give some real quick figures, if I could.
Of course.
There are 15,300 dialects on the earth. Those are not languages. Because one language group can have multiple dialects. For example, in India, there are 2,032 dialects. In China, there are 436 dialects. These dialectic distinctive language groups sometimes can't even be understood over the next mountain. So we found that by training nationals, have the best way to reach the next mountain, because that next dialect may be just a variance, a little bit of the main language of Hindi or Urdu or whatever language you're in. And in the Philippines, it's Tagalog, it's Ilocano, there's a lot of different dialects. And so these nationals really are powerful. And God showed me that. I was doing large crusades around the world. I was going to the Philippines, and I don't, you know, anybody can get a crowd of thousands if they have some money.
Sure.
If you go over with money, you can get a tent, or you can get a big coliseum, and with proper advertising, even though the people don't know you that way, you'll fill the coliseum up because they're hungry. But so I was going doing large crusades. We're seeing marvelous results. Good, because I've been an evangelist, you know, before I became apostolic, and I still think I have the heart of an evangelist. Like you said, maybe
you
have a heart, multiple hearts. I have all five. You said it. And so I said, wait a minute. We're going in. We're seeing thousands of people come to Christ. What happens to them next? And so the Lord said, you got to raise up nationals in ministry. And that's my heart. Now, I've been doing this since 1988, around that time, where we went to the Philippines and we've gone to Romania. We were the first team to go into Romania after the fall of communism. They had assassinated Ceausescu and his wife on nationwide television on Christmas Eve. And then they re-showed it for 36 hours. They just kept repeating that same video. They wanted to make sure everybody in Romania knew that this couple had been assassinated. And then out of that, the gospel began to go into these nations that were communist. And so we went over and we went from plaza to plaza. We'd set up our worship. We trained in Switzerland. We went out of Milstossi, Switzerland. We rented the former castle of the headquarters of Hitler. Christians now owned it.
Listen to
in Milstossi, Austria. We looked it up on the internet, and so we took our team of 17 members from the U.S. We went in and we spent 3 days in Hitler's former headquarters out of Austria for Austria. But I'm just showing you that in the end, God wins.
Hey.
See, what the enemy may accomplish for a while, they don't win. God won that beautiful castle. And so we went in there and trained our team. We could be set up, Daniel, on the street in 12 minutes. From the time our vans, we had multiple vans, we had a truck full of Bibles out of Hungary and Romanian, the first prints of the Bibles, and we'd pull up into a plaza, and in 12 minutes, we'd have our whole sound system up, and I'd be playing worship in the plaza in 12 minutes. So the security would show up to stop us, and we were already, and the Romanian people said, wait, you've oppressed us for 40 years under Ceausescu. We have new freedom in this country. And they would start beating up on the security. We had to say, wait a minute, we're not... there to beat up this. That was Ceausescu's personal. They were so mean that even the Russian mafia didn't bother them. That's how bad they were. But you know what? They didn't. We never got shut down one time in Romania.
Look at God.
And so we were in this nation, and one after another city, we began to give out Bibles. We were starting riots on the streets. We had to quit handing out Bibles on the streets because old ladies were beating up teenagers to get a Bible. Some of these old ladies had waited for 40 years to get a Bible, and they were, nothing was going to stop them. They were up there going, you know. And so, I mean, it was an exciting time. We began to go to the nations. Then we went, you know, we've been in India now. I've been doing crusades in India. I've been to so many nations. We went down to Haiti.
Africa.
It's in Africa, all through Africa. We got tremendous groups of pastors. We have one campus alone in Kenya that has 756 pastors in it. One campus. And they're going through the New Testament. Your studies you're going through, Daniel.
Yes.
And I'm telling you, we are excited. Now, Daniel has a heart for America, and I believe he's got an anointing to reach America.
Yes.
I have said it repeatedly to people when you're not here. I say, you know, if you want to study a man who has an anointing and strategies to take America, look up Daniel McGee. Daniel McGee has, I believe, the download of God.
The blueprint to take
rural America, because listen, revival is going to start in rural America. You know, the Great Awakenings were out in the middle of cornfields, in the middle of the hay fields.
And we had talked about that here in at Kingdom Life University earlier today, that, you know, you go back and you study the history of the first Great Awakening, 1740s, 50s, and into the 60s, and then you look at the second Great Awakening of 1800, where did that take place? You know, we hear the word camp meeting. Well, the very first camp meeting was in the year of 1800, out in the rural Kentucky, in a small, tiny cabin house that was very small. The power of God fell on the third night. John McGee, the Bartleman brothers, had organized a meeting. The third night, a man named John McGee gets up and speaks, and the power of the Holy Ghost fell, and they said the floor was littered with the slain.
Wow.
The power of the Holy Ghost fell, and people were out under the power of God. That was the birthing of the second Great Awakening out in the middle of a cattle field, where over 100,000 people from across the nation came in and would camp for days to hear preaching morning, noon, and night. And so we're seeing, if you will, sparks of that again in our
country.
Coming
up, it's here.
Let me use just one city for an example, okay? So there's a city in America called Moultrie, Georgia. Moultrie, Georgia is a city of about 13, 14,000 people. The Lord sent me to Moultrie, Georgia, and I met with a pastor. A pastor had heard about an event that we had done down in just about an hour south of him, and he said, "Will you come up here and meet with me?" So I went up and met with the pastor up there in Moultrie, Georgia. He said, "A year ago, God told us revival was coming."
Hallelujah.
We set aside a little account in the church, and we started raising money for revival, that revival was coming. We heard the voice of God saying revival was coming into this rural town, small place America, right? He said we raised about $6,000 is in that account, and I came in on that Sunday morning, and the account went from $6,000 to over $10,000 in one day. We put up a 1,000-seat tent outside the city in a giant grassy field in there. I'm not talking about in the middle of the city. I'm talking about in a grassy field. We put a 1,000-seater tent up, and in 6 nights, the total attendance was over 6,400 people. This is Moultrie, Georgia, 13,000 people. The total altar call.
That's a move of God.
Night number one, and then night number two.
That's like 3 million people coming out of New York.
Yes, right.
The night number two, it exploded. When I gave the altar call, there is a picture out there in the history of social media of the total attendance of night one, total attendance of night two, and the total altar call of night number two. And I'm holding this card in my hand. Now listen, we put up a 1,000-seater tent. 56 or 58 people answered the altar call on night number two to get saved. Wow. So many people showed up that there was no room to sit them. They were out sitting out all in the grass. The tent was maxed out, and it was a major move of God that hit that city. God is still doing this in America, ladies and gentlemen.
Yes, he is.
You don't hear about it on CTN and TBN and even Perry Stone. They prophesied that he wouldn't hear it like that, but the people of those areas would know it. There is a move of God happening in this nation, ladies and gentlemen, and God wants you to be a part of it.
Now,
you know what? Rural America really built this nation. If you really understand the history of America, it was rural America. If I can get, I don't want to get political, but you know, rural America really got Donald Trump elected.
Absolutely.
They said the difference was rural American people, you know, the good hardcore American that love the soil. Mm-hmm. I was raised on a farm in Colorado, mm-hmm. and the farm people are wonderful. You know, we'd shake hands with a neighbor, and that was better than a contract.
That's
right. We helped each other when harvest time came. We'd go over and help them with their grain. They'd help them come and help us with ours. There's mm-hmm. something about rural America that has a special touch on it, and I just prophesy again, Daniel, it's here.
Amen.
Just release this across America and rural America, because it's here. The Lord gave that word this morning in our classroom that the revival isn't coming. It's here. You are the revival.
Amen.
You're the revival. Stop looking at something down the road. Start using your gifts right now. Get out and pray for your neighbor. Get out and pray for the people down the street. Just go door to door and just say, listen, I just live on the street here, and God told me to come and just pray for everybody in our block. Is it okay if I pray for? Ask them, is it okay? I'll bet you 9 out of 10 people will say, yeah. What needs do you have? And then while you're praying for them, we've done this kind of thing, Daniel. So, you know, while our heads are bowed before Jesus, why don't you receive Jesus right now? And they, I don't know how amazing how many people would just bow, say, yeah, we're already praying. How do I do it? Well, I'll lead you in a prayer. You're going to do that later, Daniel. Yeah. You're the best at this.
Because they felt love, Dr.
Yeah.
Jerry.
Yeah, and that somebody cared next door.
When people feel love and they feel safe, they'll give you the shirt off their back.
Yeah, they will.
How much more their eternal soul?
So I'm telling you, we live in a day where it's not that hard to win souls. Go ahead.
You know, what you just said, let's piggyback on that. Dr. Jerry and I went to breakfast on Monday morning. Okay, so we went to breakfast Monday morning, and when Dr. Jerry, we walked into the restaurant, there was nobody there.
We were the only ones there.
In a restaurant that's normally packed, but because of what's kind of going on in America right now, the businesses are really hurting. Well, here you are, you're sitting with an apostolic prophetic voice, and you're sitting with an evangelist.
That's dangerous.
So he says, we're going to pray for business to come in, and we're going to pray for this business,
increase,
for people to start coming into the business. And immediately in my spirit, man, I go, okay, as he's going to be praying for these businesses, the business to increase, this is going to give me an opportunity to lead these people to Jesus.
Hmm.
So we call the people over there to pray for them, or to pray for the business, that more business would come, you know, declaring, sending out the Macedonian crowds, the north, south, east, and the west, that people would begin to come in and visit that establishment and spend their money there. The Holy Spirit spoke to me, and he said, and remember the scripture, money answereth all things.
That's right.
The lady handed me to my check. My check was $30.23. The Holy Spirit said, double it. So in other words, we paid the bill, and I said, I'm going to give you $30.23.
The waitress.
I said, I'm doubling my tip. Which opened up her heart for us to say, now go get the other workers, because we're going to pray for y'all. Well, she goes to the back and tries to gather some other workers. Well, there's only two waitresses in the restaurant, and there's maybe one or two cooks in the back. So the two waitresses come to us for prayer.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So Dr. Jerry prays for them, prays for the restaurant, prays for their family. And then I looked at the other girl, and I said, not only am I going to pay my $30.23 bill, but I'm giving my waitress $30.23, but I'm also giving you $30.23. So we tripled, basically paid three times. Instead of paying $30.23, we paid $90 and something. Now, here's what that opened us, opened their hearts. It opened their hearts to the love of God.
That's right.
And then I was
tears in their eyes.
And I was able to share Jesus. We shared the gospel of Jesus Christ, and they bowed their head and they prayed to receive Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord. Now let's just say that. $90, and what would that be? $90.66, if you will. That was the best $90.66 that you could ever spend. Two people connecting to Jesus.
And we'll spend eternity with them.
Isn't that a beautiful thing?
Yeah.
And you know, the heart of the evangelist, the heart of God is mercy, and the heart of God is souls, beloved. Mm. Okay, the heart of God is not prosperity and money and millionaires and all this stuff that another gospel is being preached.
It's true.
Just think about when Paul said, listen, I come back to you expecting to see how you've grown, and who has come in and taught you another gospel? Who has bewitched you?
That's what he said in Galatians.
Because they're saying, Paul, guess what we learned? Guess who taught us? And he said, Who has bewitched you? Who came preaching another gospel? He said, those that preach another gospel, Galatians 1:5, I believe it is, or 1:8, he said, let them be accursed.
Amen.
And what does the Bible say in the back of the book? It says, Amen. If any man adds or takes away from the prophecy of this book, his name shall be taken out of the Lamb's book of life. God is serious. He doesn't want anybody. Amen. He doesn't want anybody.
Don't mess with it.
Don't mess with him, because he told us, beloved of God, he told each and every one of us to have the heart of the evangelist, not the mantle of the evangelist, the heart. And he said in Mark 16. Now I put on Facebook last year, what is the Great Commission? Nobody knew. Three people knew. Wow. I have over 5,000 friends.
Wow, that's amazing.
Three people, and they didn't know what the Great Commission was. I'm not saying you don't know. You may know. But if you want to know what the Great Commission is, what every born-again, spirit-filled, blood-bought believer is supposed to be doing while we're in this earth, we are supposed to be winning souls.
Amen.
And Jesus said unto them, go ye therefore into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, after he had risen from the dead. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. But nobody preaches the second part, but he said it. And he that believeth not shall be damned. We have to save people from damnation.
Amen.
Of God. And these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name they shall cast out devils. Who even preaches anymore? Authority of the believer.
Yeah.
Luke 10:19. Matthew 10:1, Luke 9:1. Who even preaches that?
Come on.
He said, go believers. I've equipped you. Go. Cast out devils, heal the sick, raise the dead. Greater works than I do, you do it.
Amen.
Okay? So how are we going to do it? Pastors, leaders, teach your people how to seek God, and teach them how to seek God for what they're supposed to be doing. Teach them the word of God. And in my name, Jesus said, in the name of Jesus, Yeshua, cast out devils, speak with new tongues, as you spoke this morning so graciously. They shall take up serpents. And if they shall drink any deadly thing of COVID-19.
Yeah,
believers are in, they're in the corner, they're in their houses, they're wearing masks, they're afraid. And if you shall drink any deadly thing or touch any deadly thing, it shall not hurt you. You shall lay hands on the sick and you shall recover. So then after the Lord had spoken unto them, he was received up unto heaven and sat at the right hand of God. Where he ever makes intercession for us.
Amen.
And the 20th verse says in Mark 16, and they went forth and preached everywhere, the Lord himself working with them and confirming the word with signs following. Amen. And then Matthew says in Matthew 28, verse 18, and Jesus said, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Think about that. Go ye therefore, disciples, children of God, and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the name of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even until the end of the age.
This is very important now. You've got to get this. Jesus will never have more authority over the earth than he now has.
It's true.
If you're waiting for some period in the future that you think Jesus is going to reign different than he is now, how is Jesus reigning now? In you. He has given you, he's made you a king and a priest. You are raised with him. You are seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. And everything's under Jesus' feet. So since you're seated with him, they're under your feet.
That's right.
He's waiting for you to release authority, his authority. He's not going to do it. I went on a prophetic dog walk. I got this little dog, and I take him on a walk every day, you know. And while I'm walking through my community, I'm praying over the community, but also I'm getting a word from God. For some reason, God speaks to me in my prophetic dog walks.
Mm-hmm.
And here's what the Lord said. I was complaining a little bit to the Lord. This was back Passover of this year, Easter time. And I said, Lord, when are you going to stop this virus? And I heard from heaven a clear voice. He said, I can't. I said, wait a minute. Did I hear you correctly, Lord? He said, I can't. He said, I've already done everything on my part. I already sent my son. He already died. He already cleansed the earth by his blood.
Amen.
He said, but you can. You can stop it. I've given authority to you. That's what this says.
That's right. We're going to read it in a minute.
He has all power, and it's been given to the church. Yeah. In fact, if you look at Ephesians 1, it says, he raised him from the dead and seated him at his own right hand, far above all principalities and powers, to the church. This was done for the church. Jesus sat down for the church. Did you get that? So you are his manifest power. You have his authority. When you speak, God speaks, because Christ in you is your hope of glory.
That's right.
When you command the wind and the waves, Jesus is commanding through you.
That's right.
We've done it many times in outreaches. We've stopped the rain. We've commanded storms. We know how that works.
Right.
We have authority. I know in our ministry you do that. You command.
That's right.
I was sick when I came back from Africa, and God said, listen, I've already done my part on your healing. That's what he told me. He said, my son came down and shed his blood for your healing.
Yeah.
Why are you begging me for healing? You command it. It's inside of you because Christ is in you. You have authority over sickness. You speak it to your body. It turned my body all around. I had 30 pounds of edemic fluid inside of me, 2 watermelons worth of fluid, choking my lungs, choking my heart. I was in bad shape. My adrenal glands failed. I was dying. I even went to my son's bedroom. I crawled on the floor to my son's bedroom. I knocked on the door. I said, Chris. He said, Dad. He said, it's 2 a.m. I said, I don't think I'm going to make it through the night. I just wanted to say goodbye. He said, Dad, what are you talking about? I said, you know what? I can't breathe. My heart's quitting. And boy, I went back to the bedroom, and my wife said, I want you never to say one word again that you're sick. She said, if I ever hear the words you're sick out of your mouth and you've owned that sickness, she said, I'm going to come down on you.
That's a good wife.
She said, you're healed, and you start declaring it over your body.
That's a good
Thank
help
you,
me.
Honey.
That's a
you
good.
Say you saved my life, literally. Mm-hmm. And I began speaking over my body and commanding it in the name of Jesus. Mm-hmm. And you know what? My doctor told me, and 30 days later, he said, what are you doing? He said, all that fluid's going out of your body. I said, I've been commanding. He said, what is it? He's Hindu. You know, Dr. Patel, one of the 1,000 Patel doctors in Tampa. And he said, whatever you're doing, keep doing it. I said, I'm going to keep doing it. And he said, but remember, you still have diabetes. So I said, don't tell me that. Don't curse me.
Right.
He's kind of startled, you know, with me. I know right. When I go to the doctor, I
That's
shake him
right.
up a
don't
little
speak
bit.
That over
I said, I don't own that disease. I said, I'm healed.
That's right.
You know, I got a word in Jerusalem.
That's
when
true.
You walk by faith, you're already there.
That's right.
That's right. That's right. That's right.
Good word.
That's right. When
okay,
you walk
anyway,
by faith,
I'll turn it over to you,
what,
doctor.
What Dr. Jerry was saying is the authority. The authority. Okay. Now you know we're going to read Matthew 10:1, Luke 10:11, and Luke 18:10-11, and Matthew 9:1. But before I'm going to read that, and then I'm going to turn you loose. You go into a town going after souls because you said something so good. So much was good. This we had a service here this morning before we did this program.
Oh, powerful.
It was powerful. Okay.
Powerful.
We had the move of the Spirit of God came. We went like an hour over, which is no time in the Spirit.
Yeah.
And you said, when you show up, things begin to happen.
That's
God
exactly
can't do
right.
anything till you show up.
That's it.
Because God had spoken to me years ago, when I walk in a room, devils
changes
stand
the
at
atmosphere.
Attention. They
That's
change their standard attention.
Change.
They may still be there. But they stand there that they can't talk. They can't
that's
move.
That's right.
They can't. It's because when you walk into a
you
city.
You got a chokehold.
Okay, right. That's right. When you go into a city, here, like the prophet goes into the city, Jezebel.
That's right.
Shut up. Because the prophet's assigned to shut Jezebel up and Leviathan and Pathan and pull them down.
Amen.
Okay, and then the prophet is trained with the Jezebel spirit as the teacher through the hand of God to teach the prophet how to overcome and defeat Jezebel.
Sure.
So God trained his prophet like Elijah with Jezebel chasing and betraying and all the stabbing and all this stuff. But you go into a city, man of God, and the devil stand at attention because they know they're going to lose souls. Because you come in the power and authority of Jesus Christ. You don't come in as Daniel McGee. You come in as Jesus Christ. We are co-ambassadors with Jesus Christ.
Right.
And I'm going to read these three scriptures, and then you're going to, I'd like you to tag team me, because
okay,
you have an
sure.
evangelistic heart.
I do
have,
too, yeah.
You have all, you have the five, you have the Father,
yeah.
the Prophet, the Pastor, Teacher, Evangelist,
yeah.
the Apostolic, and you have the evangelist heart with the prophetic anointing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Yeah.
Now, Matthew 10:1, and when he had called his 12 disciples together, if you are a disciple, the Bible says, if you study after the word of God, then are you my disciples indeed, Jesus said, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. The truth won't set you free, it's the truth you know.
Yeah,
you have to know. You have to know this.
Come on.
Okay, you have to know this.
Jesus.
And so you become a disciple of God if you study in the Word, okay? The Bible says in Proverbs 4, my son, getting back to your wife, telling you what you needed to hear.
Absolutely.
My son, Proverbs 4, 20 and 22, my son, attend to my words, incline thine ear unto my sayings, keep them in the midst of thine heart. Listen,
good
God
word.
Says. Listen, my son, my daughter, my son, inclusive, incline thine ear unto my sayings. Say, well, I can't hear God right here.
There it is.
He's talking right there.
This is God.
Open the Bible. Start reading.
We have a talking God with a talking book. You have to have a listening ear.
Right.
My son, attend to my words. Incline thine ear unto my sayings. Keep the, let them not depart from before thine eyes. Read. Keep them in the midst of thine heart. For my words, they are life unto those that find them, and health and medicine to all their flesh. Proverbs 18:21 says, death and life are in the power of the tongue, and
absolutely.
Those that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. You could have died.
I could.
So if you would have been rebellious and said to your wife, you know what, blah, blah, you'd be dead.
You know the word God gave me?
Because you owned it. You owned it.
This one verse, I think I told Daniel yesterday, I think I quoted it 10,000 times before I was totally well, which I am now. If the same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead dwell in me, he will quicken my, not my spirit man, it's sort of been quickened. He'll quicken my mortal body by the same spirit that dwells in me and in him. So I thought, man, if that spirit that raised Jesus from the dead, he can raise my body.
And he did. This was recent.
This is just last April. And I've never been healthier in my life, Daniel.
This man.
I'm ready to go bass fishing with you.
he has the energy of a 40-year-old.
A 77, man. I'm just getting started. In fact, I'm going to enter my ministry at 80 like Moses.
That's
so
right.
I've been practicing for 57
Caleb
years.
Caleb and Joshua, give me that mountain.
I love it.
You're getting refired. Give
I'm
me that mountain.
Refired.
So we have the authority. You say, well, when Daniel comes into a city, that will stand the attention. When this man of God comes into a city or steps in a platform, devils may be in the serve, they stand at attention. Matthew 10:1. This is for you. This has been my heart's cry since God called me to minister. Sheep, wake up.
Come on.
You're living, the prison door has been open. What are we doing?
Ooh.
Living inside like a scared little mouse waiting for the snake to come through the gate and bite us and poison us and paralyze us. We have the power, beloved.
Amen.
Matthew 10:1. And when he had called his unto himself his 12 disciples together, you are his disciples. Say, oh, that no. If you continue in the word, you are his disciples.
That's right.
And he gave them power over against unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease. Okay? So let's go over here. So Luke 10.
Same thing.
Let's go 70 Luke,
there,
Luke,
right?
Yes.
Wow.
Before we do that, let's do Luke 9:1. And Luke 9:1 says, Luke 9:1 says, then he, Jesus, called his 12 disciples together and gave them power and authority over all devils and demons to cure diseases, sickness and diseases, oppression from the devil. God doesn't send sickness and disease.
That's right.
And to cure diseases, and he sent them to preach the
kingdom of God
and to heal the sick. And Luke 10, now Jesus said, listen, before I turn him loose, because these men, they're walking in their authority. We're walking in our authority because we know by the grace of God who we are. And we want you to know. Okay, we are Jesus' hands in the earth, beloved. So Luke 10:18 and 19, yes, thank you. And he said unto them, 17. And the 70 disciples returned with him, saying, Lord, even the devils are subject unto us through thy name.
Hallelujah.
Oh, man.
Good report.
Oh, man. And he said, well, how'd you do, guys? Jesus, the devils, you told us to do it, and we did it, and they listened in your name. And the 70 returned, saying, and he said unto them, listen, behold, I saw Satan fall from heaven as lightning fall from heaven. Behold, I give unto you, the disciples, the born-again spirit-filled, power and authority to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing by any means shall hurt you. Now listen to verse 20. Notwithstanding in this, rejoice not, that the spirits are subject to you, rather than rejoice because your names are written in heaven.
Hallelujah.
The Lord said demons are like, yep. Big deal. They come out. Rejoice. The greater rejoice that you're in heaven.
Oh, who?
So let me just kind of tell you guys my first story of casting out a demon. I didn't come from a background like we are in now and like you're hearing from, a word of faith background or a spirit-filled background. I was a part of a denomination that didn't even believe these things, didn't believe in casting out devils, didn't believe in laying hands on the sick, didn't believe in the baptism of the Holy Spirit with the evidence speaking in tongues, didn't believe that there was apostles and prophets anymore. I was a part of a licensed minister in that denomination. Then I started renewing my mind to the Word of God, started reading the Word of God for myself. God wants you to renew your mind to the Word of God on a daily basis. So the more I read the Word, the more I found out the truth. So here I am on an airplane flying to Africa, and because I have read the Word of God and nobody taught me, the Holy Spirit will teach you as you read.
Absolutely.
Well, I've heard people say, well, I don't know what to do. I said, just start reading your Bible.
Here it comes.
And the Holy Spirit will show you and lead you what to do.
Baby steps.
So here it is. I'm on the airplane, and the guy, long story short, manifests a demon sitting right next to me on the airplane. You're in a 13-hour flight. The guy's eyes roll in the back of his head all white. He growls and he swings at me. We're sitting next to air on an airplane just like this. Nobody taught me how to cast devils out. But I had read of the ministry of Jesus.
Come on.
I had read Mark chapter 16, verses 15 through 20, where Jesus said, these signs will follow them that believe in my name, they'll cast out devils. Well, that was me, because I was a follower of Jesus. All I could remember is the words of Jesus, hold thy peace and come out of them.
Yeah.
Well, I used my southern vernacular because I'm from the south. I say, shut up in the name of Jesus and come out.
That's all.
For 6 hours, I worked on that young man who had multiple demons in him. The young man fell head forward into my lap, weeping and crying. Not only did he get saved, glory to God, he received the baptism of the Holy Ghost with evidence speaking in tongues right there on the airplane. He got delivered from all them devils and demons. He got saved, glory to God, and he received the baptism of the Holy Spirit because I had read the Word of God and studied the Word of God. The Holy Spirit will teach you. Jesus even said that. Jesus said the Holy Spirit will bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I've said to you. Now watch this. If you're not reading the Bible, you don't know what he said.
And he'll always talk about Jesus.
And he'll always glorify Jesus. Here we are on Sunday, this Sunday evening. I'm on the upper Gulf Coast up there in the Mobile, Alabama area, Pensacola, Florida area. And I have been given permission from a Mexican restaurant to use this great outdoor venue that they have every Sunday afternoon. This Sunday I was preaching this message. What did Jesus do? What would Jesus do now? And what should the church be doing now? So we went through the Word of God, and then I gave an altar call. People answered the altar call to receive Jesus Christ as their Savior and Lord in this Mexican restaurant out on this big beautiful deck overlooking the water. Then the Lord said, lay hands on the sick. Laid hands on the sick, and the power of God hit people. Then the Lord told me to call 5 people out to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in tongues. Laid hands on the people. Glory to God. The last person, when I got ready to lay hands on the lady, she manifested multiple demons, began bucking, kicking, growling. And I thought we were having the most wonderful time with Jesus.
Yeah.
So this woman in front of everybody, after people get saved, after people get People were healed. People started receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit with evidence of speaking in tongues. Yep. This woman gets delivered from devils and demons. The ministry of Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And he's given it to us, the church.
That's right.
To go into the world to do what he said do.
We are his Jesus Christ, Malachi 3:6. I am the Lord, I change not. Say, oh, that's just God the Father. Hey, Hebrews 13:8. Jesus Christ. How clear is that? The same yesterday, today, and forever. Mm-hmm. Okay? And so we are his, we are co-ambassadors with him. He's seated at the right hand of God. The Holy Spirit is in the earth. We are co-ambassadors with Jesus Christ. He needs us. And so we have about 10 minutes left. A couple of more minutes. Man.
Okay, yeah. Let's, all right, let's do
it. Either one of you tell the pastors how to grow their churches.
Yeah.
Well, the way to grow your church is to get them out of the building. Thank God for COVID-19. It's got the church out in the streets now. It's got them in restaurants.
That's right.
I mean, you know, we were worshiping our buildings. Let's be honest.
That's good.
And the church was kind of stuck in the building. Now they're out.
You know, Dr. Jerry, and to piggyback on what Dr. Jerry's saying here is, we've never shut down.
No.
I'm a street ministry. We have never shut down. Yeah. We have been to the streets every week. We have mobilized door knocking every single week. Since the COVID-19 has kind of kicked off really strongly in the March, April timeframe, we've led over 2,000 people to Jesus, done community cookouts, went into laundromats, paid for everybody's laundry multiple times. We've done this multiple times, gone to restaurants and bought all the food for everybody in restaurants several times, given away cars. We've never stopped doing what Jesus said do.
Yeah.
The lost are still being saved. Hallelujah. People are still being receiving the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Mm. You're a pastor and you're watching, you're going, you know, how do I grow my church? What do I do to grow my church? Well, listen, let me tell you something very simple. Mobilize everybody in your church. Take a 1 mile radius around your building, knock on every single door of that, and give them an invite to a free community cookout at your church.
And light the barbecue up when, so it covers the whole community. Everybody's going to smell the barbecue.
That's right.
We were downtown in San Francisco. God led me to the streets of San Francisco. I had a nightly television show in Northern California every night of the week at 11 o'clock at night on a big station there. Mm-hmm. And God just used that to mobilize churches. So I was taking churches out to the streets. We're at Haight-Ashbury. If you remember Haight-Ashbury back in the 60s,
California.
That's where all the hippies hung out. So we blocked off the entire street. So we're setting up a band there named Deliverance out of a church in Vallejo, California, Assembly of God Church. The name of the band was Deliverance. How appropriate. And so I'm standing out there. Well, we're getting ready to launch the outreach, and this young man comes across the street and just walks right up to me. And he says, what's going on here? He said, is this a rock concert? I said, yeah. I said, The Rock. He said, who is The Rock? I said, Jesus Christ. He said, ooh, that's heavy. I said, he's one heavy rock, dude. I said, you know what? You're into witchcraft. He said, how did you know that? I said, God just told me you're into witchcraft.
Beautiful.
He said, could you help me? I said, no, I can't, but I know somebody that can. He's going to do it right now. He's going to set you free. So I told the whole band, come over here, guys. Let's pray for this guy before you play. Your name's Deliverance. Let's practice it. So we all hit the street. We all knelt down right on the street. And I led him through a deliverance. This young man, I'm telling you, when he came up, when these demons left him, these witchcraft demons, he jumped straight up in the air and screamed so loud. He announced our outreach, I think, for three blocks out. And you know, he's standing there and he's going, wow,
heavy,
they're gone.
Heavy, man, heavy.
They're gone, yeah. He said, they're gone. He said, man, I've got joy. He said, I haven't had peace like this. So I checked with him throughout the outreach tonight. I said, how you doing? Oh, I'm just enjoying my peace. He said, man, he was delivered.
A true
deliverance. See, God is doing it. God is setting people free.
Tell people now that may be bound. We have about 6 minutes, and okay. You with men of God, a salvation prayer.
Well, let me tell you how demons operate. They operate in two principles. They operate territorially. Give no place to the devil. They operate by permission. Everybody that's demon indwelt, demon possessed, has given permission to those demons by things they've done with their body. Mm-hmm. By things they've looked at with their mind, mm-hmm. eyes, mm-hmm. they've given permission for demons to take stronghold in their life. Mm-hmm. So permission has been given, And territory has been given. Demons are they're without bodies. They're looking for bodies all over the place to dwell in. Mm-hmm. They're looking for bodies. They're looking for you. Mm-hmm. And so what you do to get rid of demons is simple. Mm-hmm. Take away their territory submitting it to the Lord Jesus Christ and bring it under the authority of the Word of God and the blood of Christ. And then take away their permission by command. You don't play mind games with demons. You tell them in the name of Jesus. They're a personality. It's like telling the neighbor's dog to get off your lawn. You know, in the name of Jesus, come out. Get out of this body now. You have no right or authority. And I have the person participate with me, this young man on the street. Mm-hmm. I said, you tell me, you command this thing. You have authority over it because you just received Jesus in your heart. Mm-hmm. Christ is now in you. Mm-hmm. You take authority over this demon. He did exactly what I said. And all, this demon came out of him, and praise I'm telling Lord. You, it was exciting. Dan, you want to leave?
And you could be set free, and this man of God is going to lead you in deliverance if you choose, which you'd be wise
Amen.
To choose. And this man of God is going to lead you into salvation. We have about 5 minutes left, and then I want to have time to find out, to let you know where you can contact either one of these men of God and support their ministries. Amen?
Here's what I'm going to do first right here is if you're struggling with an addiction or a bondage in the area of mind or your physical
right.
body, we're going to take authority over that right now in the name of Jesus. Then I'm going to have you renounce that.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm right now, in the name of Jesus,
in the name of
we
Jesus.
Take authority over every tormenting thing, every yes. unclean thing, every yes. lying yes. thing that would torment these people
yes.
in
yes.
Jesus' name.
Yes.
We call you a vile trespasser in the name of Jesus. We break your right now in Jesus' name to people's minds and bodies and homes. And we command you to go in the name of Jesus.
Go in the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus. Now, all you got to do is just say, in the name of Jesus, I command that, and whatever it is, let's say it's a spirit of addiction. I command the spirit of addiction to leave me in Jesus' name. And it'll go.
Depression,
it'll go. Anxiety, it'll go.
Suicide.
Fear, it'll go. A suicide, it'll go. You command it to go, and it will go in the name of Jesus.
Unforgiveness.
Unforgiveness, bitterness, all of those things, they'll go.
Yeah.
Anger, wrath. The spirit of murder, it'll go in the name of Jesus. You command it to be gone in Jesus' name.
Timidity,
low self-esteem, any of those things, you renounce
rejection.
Those things. Anything that the enemy would try to put in your mind that would not exalt the word of God, you give it no legal right, you command it to go. The next thing we're going to do now, maybe you're watching today and you're not 100% sure that if you breathed out your last breath, that you would make it to heaven to be with Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
The Bible clearly teaches us that there's a heaven to gain and a hell to shun.
Mm-hmm.
The wages of sin, the things we've done wrong, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God's eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And the Bible says that whoever would call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved.
Mm-hmm.
Today you're watching. You can put your death, your faith in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus
yes.
and call on Him as your saving Lord, and you can be
now.
Saved. Jesus said you must be born again. If that's you and you're watching, I want you to bow your head and say this with me now. Say, Dear Lord Jesus.
Dear Lord Jesus.
I ask you now.
I ask you now.
To come into my heart.
To come into my heart.
To be my Savior.
Be my Savior.
And be my Lord.
Be my Lord.
I repent.
I repent.
Of all my sin.
Of all my sin.
Of the ways of the world.
Of the ways of the world.
And I confess now.
And I confess now.
That Jesus Christ.
That Jesus Christ.
Is the Lord of my life.
Lord of my life.
I give you my heart, Jesus.
I give you my heart.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
For saving me, man.
Amen.
Amen. If you said that prayer, we believe amen. That today Jesus came into your heart and you are born again.
Amen, amen. And the Bible says in Romans chapter 10, verse 9 and 10, if you will confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and shall believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. Verse 10, Romans 10, verse 10. For with the heart man amen. Believes unto righteousness, and with your mouth confession is made unto salvation. So you are now born again. You are filled with the Spirit of God. Okay? For God so loved the world, He gave His only begotten Son,
amen.
That whosoever shall believe in Him, John 3:16, shall not perish but have everlasting life. When you close your eyes, beloved, for the last time, you will find yourself to be absent from the body, to be present with the Lord. Not only will you be ushered into heaven, okay? You will be with Jesus forever and ever in a beautiful place called heaven that the Bible talks about. You can read Revelation 4, you can read Revelation 21, you can read Revelation 22 about heaven. If you don't have a Bible, go to a Bible bookstore, whatever city you're in, tell them you just got saved. Can you get a Bible? If you don't have the money, ask them for a full gospel church and ask the pastor, can you teach me about God? Can you get me a Bible? And I guarantee you, you are on the greatest adventure of your life.
Amen.
And so today is your day. The angels in heaven are rejoicing, the Bible says. We are rejoicing.
Yeah.
And you know what? If you're in the pig pen and you left God, you come back to Father. God is preparing a party for you. So we have 1.5 minutes. I'm going to let these gentlemen tell you where they can be reached. And you might want to reach out to the evangelist. Pastor, show honor to him. Pay his plane fare, pay his way. He doesn't ask for a lot, a place to eat, a place to sleep, and a church to preach. And guess what? He will turn your city upside
Amen.
Down. He will
Amen.
Teach you and your people how to win souls for God. And we're going to tell them how they can reach you, man of God.
You can reach me through Facebook at Pastor Daniel McGee. You can call our ministry at 251-327-6633. That's there in Mobile, Alabama, to Rural Revival America. Just reach out to us, or you can contact Dr. Jerry Brand at Kingdom Life University, and he can give you my information as well, Dr. Jerry.
Well, our online address is KLU, that's initials for Kingdom Life University, KLUonline.com, real simple. And Daniel can tell you how easy it is to navigate through the whole campus and the whole program, the curriculum. It's really easy and beautiful. Join up. Become a student with us. Get your credit. For a price of a specialty cup of coffee a day, you can be a full-time student with Kingdom Life University.
And you know, there's books here. We're going to have another program because we did. The Holy Ghost spoke about souls, spoke about the other things that were on his heart. But this is just as important.
Yes.
So we're going to have to do another program because this
Father
man
books.
Also, he's a writer. He's not only a father, he's a writer. So we're out of time. I love you more and more. Thank you, man of God. My pleasure to have you on the
thank
program.
You. Honored to be here
thank
with you.
You. Well, thank you. Such an honor. And thank you. I'm honored that you watch this program. Ann Finkelman, Shoshana Ministries International, Messianic Ministry, Prophetic Ministry. Listen, join me on Facebook. I'd love for you to be a part. You won't get hurt. I don't allow people to get hurt. Anybody that comes around me or in the ministry. We'll love you, we'll honor you, and we want to get you into your God-given destiny. Thank you for watching. Subscribe to our YouTube channel, Shoshana Ministries International, Shoshannah. Ministries International, hit the bell. Every time we upload with wonderful men and women of God, you'll be notified. And it's free to you. Really, I've received free gift for this program. I love you more and more. Thanks for the company. I love you. Mwah. I'll see you next time. Bye-bye.